Welcome to the Public Voice Salon. My name is John Braden. I'm the host and co-founder of the show with my wife Claudia, who's filming us right now here at the Sideshow Art Gallery in Williamsburg, Brooklyn, one of my favorite neighborhoods in the world for its aesthetic culture and sense of community. I first discovered this neighborhood back in 2007 when I came to a modern dance piece that was being held here. And actually it was in some warehouse. It was like, you know, we had to actually get into a car and drive to the exhibition, which was kind of very interesting. And I looked around me and it was like I had this sense of wonder at this neighborhood that seemed like it was caught in a time capsule of sorts. I felt like I was back in the 70s. There was, sneakers hanging from the wires. There was graffiti. And I discovered, you know, this incredible scene. I discovered a bookstore called Spoonbill in Sugartown, which is one of the greatest bookstores I've been in. And then soon after that, I began teaching at Barriqua College in the neighborhood. And I was so enchanted by the neighborhood that I began taking my students out to galleries, and that was the curriculum. I didn't use the textbook. We would go to galleries, and for many of the students, it was their first time ever into an art gallery. So it's such a joy and pleasure to be here today. And this is our first show in a gallery in Williamsburg. It's always been a dream of mine. And we're so lucky that we got to film at the Sideshow Gallery with Richard Timperio, nice Italian name, nice Italian guy. There's a lot of Italians in this neighborhood, I think, too. Yeah. So we're just going to...
Actually, at one point, it was a Lithuanian neighborhood.
Really?
In the early 50s, yeah. Oh. And there used to be, like, beer gardens on all the corners and stuff like that here.
And a lot of Polish also, a lot of Polish.
Polish and Hispanic. Mm-hmm. And then in the 70s, they closed the Navy Yard and... The Navy Yard's right over here, and also they closed a brewery, Schaefer Brewery, and it sort of became like an abandoned place.
And you helped to transform this place.
Well, I guess. Okay. By default.
Uh-huh. And here's what I love. This idea came in a cafe that was on Bedford Avenue. What was it that gave you the idea? The first gallery incarnation was in a coffee shop.
Right? See, one of the things was is that everybody who lived here, and actually most of the people that are here, Larry and Kim and Denise and Marianne.
Come on, everybody. Come together. Why don't you guys come? We're all together. Yeah, okay, yeah.
Yeah, and so what really happened is that it became a place. I'd been out west, and I came back, and I was looking for a place to work. And it was super cheap, and it was so close to Manhattan. So all you had to do is jump on the Williamsburg Bridge, and you were in Soho. Most of the people I knew at that time were in Soho. And so you could get a space. I had a 3,000 square foot loft with a view of Manhattan for $300 a month. And so, and then you could just jump on the bridge and you're in Manhattan. Mm. So it was a perfect place for a working artist. And that's what really helped develop the whole thing. At one point, it was one of the largest congregations of artists in the world.
Wow.
It's not that anymore.
Okay.
But there was a period of time just before it took off to whatever it is going to now, you know. And so what happened is...
Yeah. So I just want to just also introduce everybody who's here and just say a few words about yourself and about this gallery and just to introduce to the public. This is about a half hour segment. We're about maybe 5 minutes into it. Mm-hmm. So we don't know exactly what we're going to do either. So we're open. This is a spontaneous show. So we like things to happen in the moment. And that's very much like this neighborhood as well, the ethos of spontaneity. So hi.
Hey, how you doing?
All right.
Welcome to the Berg.
Thank you. It's good to be in the Berg.
What would you like to know?
Your name?
Larry Webb.
And you're an artist?
I'm an artist. I've been here since 1977.
How do you like this gallery?
Well, Everybody here loves it. We call Rich the Sage of Williamsburg.
The Sage of Williamsburg, ladies and gentlemen. Here he is. Here he is. Thank you, Larry. And you have a piece here also? You have a piece? Show us your piece.
Well, it's up here. You can't see it.
So tell us quickly about your work.
Well, I'm an abstract painter. Okay. And I'm from Kansas. And
you're not in Kansas anymore.
No, I'm not.
Okay.
And I basically came here for art. And I answered an ad in the Village Voice about a loft in Williamsburg. And I came over. I was living in my pickup truck, and I rented this loft, and I've been here ever since. And there was times when my wife asked me what we were doing over here. And that was usually when the bullets were flying through our windows.
God. There are times when my wife asks me, what are we doing with this show? So don't worry, Larry. I understand you. And then we have, hi, how are you?
Hi.
What's your name?
Denise Corley.
Denise, and how do you know Mr. Richard over here?
Because he runs this great gallery.
Uh-huh.
And I started coming to see this show, and it was so fantastic that I wanted to be in it. So I asked him if I could be in it, and I am a former neighbor of Larry's. He was on the block before me, and we're talking 30 years ago.
So Richard and Larry are the two guys that made it all happen. I just have a feeling that before Richard and Larry, this place was what? It was really...
There was a lot of people. There was just a lot of people, not all from the Midwest, but a lot of us were. So I'm from Detroit originally.
And you have a piece in the show?
Yes, it's in the back room.
Okay, we'll take a look at it later.
Okay,
it's so good to have you here. And
I got to tell you what she did.
Okay.
This is a fabulous thing here. She's the ultimate organizer.
Oh.
Yeah, we are hands down.
Can you come to our apartment? Okay.
She's created this wonderful thing where you can find anything in here, where you go to a page.
You did this?
Yeah.
I did do this because I felt like it was something that needed to be done.
She was right.
Yeah. She was right. You got to be organized.
She said it needed to be done. I was going, who's going to do it?
I find, too, as a writer, that there has to be a certain structure, you know. You have to have time to work on your craft. Right. And as artists as well, you know, you can't be too ephemeral with it. Like, oh, I'll get inspired and do it. There has to be a kind of a structure. But you've created this sort of a structure here, Richard, that's also very social. And I like that. I like social. I like interconnection. And when I used to bring my students into galleries here, we would walk in, and my students would be, like, a little nervous. You know, they had never been to an art gallery before. So they would walk in, but there was always a sense of interconnection here, which I don't think would happen in certain other galleries. We're not going to mention any other galleries in other neighborhoods like Chelsea, but no. But there was, you know, there was a certain coziness, a certain caring, a certain.
You need to feel good. Yeah. When you enter the space, and that's how you sort of deal with the space, is that when someone walks in and they can see whatever's on the walls, and they can understand whatever it is, or they could ask the question. So it's good that, you know, it's open to whoever comes to see it, because that's what it's about.
Wow. We want to be open to the other people now who want to come and just say hello and introduce themselves to our audience. This is being broadcast in that other borough called Manhattan across the river, you know. You know, Claudia and I, we came from Hoboken, so we came, you know, it was an adventure to get here, let's just say. It was a great journey, and the bus, with the L train. So I was just saying that, you know, it was a journey to get here, and it started to snow today, which is also very magical to be in Williamsburg on a snowy day. But the L train was not working, so we had to take a bus, and we're stuck in traffic on 14th Street. And I said to Claudia, I said, Manhattan is conspiring to keep us from Brooklyn, and they're not going to win. We're going to get to Brooklyn. I feel like this is the place where I'm the happiest. This neighborhood, this borough, there's something going on here. I know Jonathan Lethem left, and he's in California now, but he was also a part of why I fell in love with Brooklyn, was reading his essays and his writings. There is a democratic ethos. There is an authenticity that you don't get even in Manhattan with the corporatization that's going on. So this feels much more open. It feels much more human. I've always felt a sense of humanity. So we're going to give everyone here a chance to say a few things.
My name is Kim Sloan, and we are really newcomers over here. We don't have the long, hard history that you've just heard about.
What's new?
No, I don't even know. I don't even know how long we've been here now, but less than 10 years, less than 10 years.
Wow.
So this was for me, you know, a lot of my friends were over here. I knew about the scene, but we were very late in joining it. But this, working with the show and working with Rich, you know, gave me an opportunity to really, it was like a instant introduction, which has been great. You know, we just met everybody and helped out. So it made us, I think, feel like we were part of the community very, very quickly. So we love to help. We'd love to help the show, and it's a fantastic community event. And all those words you just used, humanity, yeah. democratic, you know, it's really what it's all about, is bringing everyone in. Everyone hangs. I've never heard Rich turn anyone away. Honestly, and he treats everybody with tremendous respect and equal respect, no matter if you're the world's famous artist or somebody who's only here for one show. So the whole thing just feels good. You know, it feels good to work on. It feels good to be in. And everyone feels that way, I think. Everyone who's in the show. And the opening, as you may or may not know, is a mob scene. You know, there's a line down the street. Even in the freezing cold, people are just waiting and waiting. So it's a huge, big neighborhood event, and it's become a really special thing for everybody.
Wow. Yeah, you know, this, I can't tell you how happy I feel when I come into this neighborhood. There's something that I just perk up, and I feel like there's a sense that something could happen, like an interaction could happen, whether it's in a coffee shop or whether it's in a gallery, that in Manhattan and in other places, there's like a scrim that separates you from the other. And I'm a big fan of Martin Buber. I've talked about this on our show before, who is a great theologian of dialogue. And he wrote a book in 1938 called I and Thou, where you treat the other as a thou, and that religious feeling comes through the interconnection and the details of sacred conversation and interaction. And I feel like here there's more of a possibility of a social interaction. And Kim, you also have a work here of a bird, a beautiful bird that looks very transcendent and colorful. It's the most colorful bird. It's like a rainbow-colored bird. Talk briefly about that.
I think you just said pretty much what I might say. But yeah, it's just it's pretty much out of my head. It's not any specific kind of bird. It's supposed to be... I like the word transcendent. That's a nice word for it, so I appreciate that.
So thank you. You're very into nature. You're focusing on nature in your life and in your work?
It's not done from life. It's not done from nature. It's more imagination intersecting with nature.
Art is a magical space in between the real and the unreal, and it can be what you want it to be. So now, thank you, Kim, very much. Thank you.
Thank you.
Who do we have here? Tell us your name. Introduce yourself to the world. This is going out in Manhattan, but also in Hoboken, New Jersey, and also it goes on television in Union City and Weehawken and North Bergen and those towns, which are along the Hudson River there. So people, you know, give people a chance, and on the internet around the world. So now you're an internationally, like I'm an internationally ignored writer. So that's why nobody, you know, my books are all self-published, you know, but now you have our public, and tell us a little bit about Williamsburg and what brought you here and what makes you an artist.
Okay. Well, first of all, thank you for coming here.
And your name?
My name is Marianne Gagné. Okay. And I am a newcomer. I've only been here like 8 years. I moved here from Manhattan.
Yeah. Emigrated from Manhattan.
Emigrated from Manhattan. Uh-huh. And heard about this show. It was already famous. And feel privileged to be a part of it and to work on it. It's really a testament to Rich and his generosity to the community. It has a uniquely inclusive spirit, but the other part of it is that it's also very carefully curated and hung, and each piece is placed very carefully, and it gives it a unique kind of coherence. So it's a real labor of love, but it's also one person's vision. So
I just realized that a half hour is not enough time. We're definitely going to have to come back, like over the summer, and to get into a deeper dialogue where we can talk about the meaning of this neighborhood in terms of art and democracy and what it means. And also for like the larger world, I always felt like when I discovered Williamsburg, it was like a best kept secret, but it was one I wanted to share. I wish that more people would know about it. And I don't just mean in the gentrified sense that, okay, now like rich people are going to come in and move. I'm not against rich people. You know, they have a right to be here too. And maybe some of the folks who are here in the fancy condos, maybe because they studied business or something, maybe their art knowledge might be a little lacking too, you know, that there could be a sort of a dialectic between the, you know, the newcomers and the people in the neighborhood, that art has a capacity to bring people together, to elevate, and also just to free people to interpret the work and have those conversations. I'm really interested in the connection between art and conversation, and also the art of conversation. So let's bring another person into our conversation, and tell us your name.
Terry Ellerbrock, Teresa Ellerbrock.
And where are you from, Terry?
I live in Manhattan.
Okay.
And
You can admit that here in Brooklyn? I won't tell anybody. I won't.
In Chelsea, no less.
Okay. All right.
But I've been there since a long time, since 1979.
Okay. Maybe we can humanize the Chelsea Gallery people. Maybe they'll watch this and they'll say, "Hey, maybe they got a point. Maybe we got to be a little more open and, you know, more friendly." You know, sometimes you walk into a Chelsea Gallery, it's like, it's very cold feeling. You know.
It is very cold. It's very intimidating. And this is much. It's much different. I mean, well, they have high rents.
Yes.
But anyway, I've been helping Rich work on this show since the beginning, at least the beginning in this space, when he did it at Planet Thailand. I didn't help, but
Planet Thailand? What was Planet Thailand?
Planet Thailand or the original?
Okay.
Yeah. And so I look forward to working every year, and I think every year it has a new sort of level of development every year. You know, different people help, and then there are people who consistently help, and it's gotten to be much more, we've gotten to be more efficient at the whole process of hanging, and
It's organic, and it's evolving,
it's organic, and you know, there's a certain rhythm that happens, but every piece that goes on the wall, Rich says, okay. You know, someone may choose a piece, but nothing goes on the wall unless...
He's the guy you got to be nice to. Okay. Come on in here, Rich. We want to bring you into the dialogue here. Let's have like a little...
He really has an overview of the entire space because it is his space and because he understands the space. He has an overview of what works. And... you know, but we've gotten to be good partners in this process of hanging, you know.
I want to pose a question to everybody in the room, and anybody could respond to this question, which is this. Given the importance of art, if we look at our educational system in our country today, which seems to be giving short shrift to the arts, right? And even when they do cover art, it's usually in the guise of a standardized format, like what's the right answer? I'm an English teacher, so I know that, forget about it. Most people go to school and they learn to hate to read because of the way it's processed there, you know. I was talking earlier about the novel A Tree Grows in Brooklyn, which was set in this neighborhood, and I just found out that the tree was a Chinese tree, indigenous to China, and it was in an empty lot somewhere, and that was the tree based in the novel, and that the girl in the novel, I think her name was Francine, she wanted to reinvent herself because she grew up very poor and in a poor family, and so she was all about reading, and she wanted to go to a different school, you know, and they had to kind of lie to get her into a better school, and her father was an alcoholic. So all of that educational, but thinking about the arts and education in terms of what would it take for our viewers who are watching our show. They're looking at the show, watching on the couch. We like people to get off the couch and get active and be in the world and not be passive. A lot of the way education is very passive. How do you get people active? How did you get active in the arts? What was the spark that made you want to become an artist? Was it in school? Was it outside of school?
I think it was outside of school. I mean, I was just very interested in seeking beauty in my life, seeking something interesting. I grew up in the country.
Where?
In Ohio. Okay. So my place to find that was in the woods, mm-hmm. or else in church, where there was interesting architecture and beautiful paintings and, you know, statues and...
sort of the spiritual aspect of art as well, right?
Just the aspect of beauty, you know, trying to find something that sparked my interest, and then mm-hmm. I just always made things, you know, no matter what. I always worked with my hands. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm a craftsperson, you know, so mm-hmm. that's how I feel. An artist, but a craftsperson, you know, I work with, I'm a weaver and
where is your piece? Let's take a look at it. Let's walk through the space now. Let's get a little active, all of us. And there's a back room here. We want to check that out. We want to make sure we see that. And let's just, and again, anybody who has anything to share, don't be shy. You know, come up to me and say it. This is a chance to really practice that articulation to the world, that breaking through a lot of the silences and corporate media that we see. You know, I think there are some wonderful things on Channel 13, and Charlie Rose has some great shows, but there's also a lot of stuff on TV that's kind of fluffy and nonsense, and you know, so we're trying to give a substantive space for real thought about art, about culture, about aesthetics, about even politics, if you have something to say about, you know, social justice. Your piece is...
My piece is over here.
Let's take a look at it over there. Ah, okay. So this is a style of abstract art. How would you describe the style?
Well, my style.
Your style, your unique style.
I mean, I think I don't really see things as a style. Okay. I think everybody is an individual, and everybody, you make what you make. You can't help what you make. You know, you try and evolve with what you're doing, but everybody does, even if you attempt to copy something, you can't really copy anything. So everybody does their own work, and I think this is such an example of, this is a celebration of creativity, this entire show.
Yeah.
You know, so it's you know, everything, every individual is their own person. It's all unique work. You know, I mean, there may be abstract painting
Okay. Those are wonderful thoughts in terms of our subjectivity and our uniqueness and our identity. But let's take it out to the world outside of this gallery, that we have a world that has poverty, that we have a world that has a dysfunctional educational system, that has an inequality of wealth, and those social problems that exist. Is there any linkage between art and social progress in any way? Can you think of any connections there in terms of making a better world? We're very interested. Yes, Larry, okay.
I think one thing you have to realize, if you want to be an artist, you have to have skill, and you have to be able to make your way. And it's just not a given that just because you have a creative mind or spirit that... you may not be able to practice that in a public venue, which again brings, we come back to Rich, which he provides a chance for people to exhibit. But my point being that art opens up the door in terms of your own personal creativity, and whether you decide to be a visual artist or not, that applies to anything that you want to do. And when I came to New York, I had no idea what I was going to do for a living. I taught after I got out of graduate school at several universities in the Midwest, and I came here and hung a sign up at Pearl Paint on Canal Street: I will paint your apartment or build you a closet for $50 a day. And that's how I started a small business here. And by the time I got done, I was renovating lofts. I did a Jim Terrell exhibition at the Whitney. I hired people from the neighborhood. I formed and incorporated a construction company. All of that was brought about by trying to find a way to pay the rent so I could make paintings. And originally I wanted to be a sailor and went to school on the GI Bill. I spent 6 years in the Navy. I went to a local museum in Wichita, saw my first de Kooning Jackson Pollock painting, which was brought about through the Johnson Wax collection. And I said to myself, you mean you can do that? And it was that exposure, and that's what brought me to New York.
Nice, very nice. Thank you for the story. Let's move through the space. We only have a few minutes left. If anybody has any other thoughts or comments or questions or want to enrich the dialogue here, we're just looking around. There's a back room here too, which is very big. Rich, have you ever had any salons here? Like people group discussions or people, what is the quality?
Not so much anything like that. I've had numerous musical events, and I've had other people readings that went on for a long time. And actually, I should put this in, is that we're going to have a musical event here on March 7th, and it's two people, one who makes his own instruments, and he makes them out of, like, kids' snow shovels and stuff like that. And then he plays all this stuff, and it's actually music. Mm. And the other person is who's going to play with him, who actually is his mentor. His name is David Van Tiegum. And David Van Tiegum, he recently composed all the music for Romeo and Juliet on Broadway. And he was the drummer for the Talking Heads and Laurie Anderson. Wow. And he plays all kinds of... You guys should come back and see this because it's really amazing. He plays all, just crazy stuff, like lamp parts, all kinds of stuff. But he's a percussionist, and he's amazing.
Let's move a little bit, Rich. Let's walk through the space a little bit. Let's get a little movement going because movement is an art also. We want to move and be active and look around. I see you have Martin Luther King over there.
Yeah, with his hands up.
Right, because that's going on in the country now. There's a civil rights issue that's very topical with the police shootings, and we're looking around, and we're trying to really figure out how art can play a role, in people's lives and our imaginations and enriching.
What it does is it makes people, if they can feel good, and you can make people feel good, and they can, like, relate to whatever it is that gets them off on whatever it is. That's the positive thing, because everybody needs some space, And so art sort of affords you a space to be who you are as you evolve, and you understand yourself or whatever it is, And it gives a lot of people where there's no place to go, a place to go.
Because a lot of people today hate their jobs. A lot of people are getting up and going through the 9-to-5 routine.
Well, we tend to live in a place that the value has become totally about money, and that's really not the whole thing. It should be more about the civilization. Mm-hmm. And if you look at any great things, there's always art within those situations, whether it's formal or it's not formal. And that should be something that's really a part of our lives. And that's what tends to start to get lost in the fact that everything's about financial gains and stuff like that. And that's determining what's good and what's bad. And that really doesn't determine what's good or bad.
So my message then also to the universe, politicians and to the real estate people, right, is that rents should be cheaper for artists, right? And art galleries matter in a community because some of these galleries are getting squeezed out and have to go to other neighborhoods because they can't.
You can't evolve. And it's getting really bad now because the fact is that the rents here are, I'm lucky I own, and that's one of the reasons that this place still exists, And that's one of the reasons. Sort of last year we called the show The Alamo, and this year it's called Circle the Wagons, like an old Western, because they're
like
coming.
John Wayne, baby, yeah, John Wayne. Come on, let's circle the wagons. And as we're winding down, just to say to our audience, any final thoughts, quickie? Both of us are learning this, so this is like an art project for us. We had no background in this. We're making it up as we go along. So,
ain't it? Sounds good.
Yeah, right?
That's what's good.
Okay.
That's what's good.
That's what's good. That's what's good.
I have to say, everybody should come by and see the show because it is really is spectacular. And it's open till March 15th. Mm-hmm. And you can come by more than once. You can come by 10 times and
you can come back and forth because it's like a crazy puzzle. So what it is a sensory overload. So when you first enter the room, you need your eyes to settle down, and it's set up in a way that all of the pictures and all of the images are like windows. And what you do is you go into different windows. If it wasn't handled right, it would be so claustrophobic in here, it would be ridiculous, you know? Yeah. But what actually happens is it feels okay, and it feels good, because you can feel all the energy from all of this creativity.
So we would want more people to come to galleries and also to talk to each other about that. This is obviously a conversation that's happening on camera, so if we were sitting down and having a cup of coffee, it would be a different conversation, but we are even though it even seems a little stilted because it's on media and we have all that background of media to deal with, right? So it's a conversation that's happening on camera, but I do think it's important. And we had a nice conversation coming in.
Community.
Though. Yeah, yeah.
See, this is a community. That's why we started at one point. Once it got a certain size, someone said you have to call it a nation. Okay. You know, and that's why it's Sideshow Nation 3. This is the third version of the nation, see? Okay. And it just progressively gets bigger all the time. Not by any, it has a life of its own.
Okay.
It actually has a life of its own, because what tends to happen is I will go back and next year I will send out an email, and everybody, all the people who are in here now will be in that email. But what will tend to happen is people are involved in their lives, and I'll get like 30% attrition.
Yeah.
And then that gets doubled.
Okay.
So like we're up to, there's 592 artists in here now.
Uh-huh.
And last year there was five.
Rich, we're going to have to cut it because we're 5 minutes over.
You
can talk for a lot. Let's continue our conversation, though, outside of the filming.
Okay.
And then think about coming back where we could have a whole hour and do something else.
Oh, that'd be cool. That'd be very cool.
The conversation will go on.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. Okay, so we're continuing on our tour of the art galleries in Williamsburg, Brooklyn. This is like our magical mystery tour, like the Beatles had a magical mystery tour. And this is our second gallery of on a snowy Saturday in February. And it's like the Arctic out there, but it's so cozy inside here at the Front Room Gallery, which is on Roebling Street. And Claudia and I walked here from the Sideshow Gallery before and out there in the snow. And as we were walking, and then I was trying to see, where's the address? Did I write it down? And then we had to actually duck into a little bar over there, and I, you know, it was good to get warm, you know. And then I reached into my, you know, my knapsack, and I found the Wag Mag, and the Wag Mag told me exactly where it was. So we have one of the founders of the Wag Mag is here. Kathleen is the owner of the gallery. Mark is also the co-owner and the founder of the Wag Mag magazine. That's Daniel. I'm sorry. Okay, Daniel. And Mark is the artist of this wonderful exhibit of beautiful, abstract, colorful works that he's going to talk about and explain. But we're going to get into a dialogue here, and we're going to talk about the art world. We're going to talk about Williamsburg. We're going to talk about who you are. And, you know, we only have a half hour. I wish we had more time, but half hour is our limit. And we're going to start with sort of walking through the space. So, Kathleen, you could introduce yourself, and then you could start us on a little tour of the place.
Well, hi, I'm Kathleen Vance, and today we have on view an exhibition by Mark Masiga, which is called Lost Horizon, and we're very lucky today to actually have the artist here, and this is Mark, just there. So I think that if we could all walk together around, Mark could talk a little bit about each piece.
And let's introduce each person before we walk around, too. Yes, you could introduce yourself.
Hi, I'm Daniel Laycock, also co-director of Front Room Gallery and founder of Wag Mag, Brooklyn Art Guide.
Very cool. Okay.
Hi, I'm Mark Masiga, the painter artist for the show.
So let us now take a tour. Kathleen, you guide us. Okay. Watch the cord. Okay.
So maybe we start with this piece. This is a work on paper. It's oil and graphite on paper. And Mark maybe can actually talk a little bit more about some of the inspiration for the for this piece.
I'm heavily influenced by my surroundings, first of all. So there are a lot of architectural references in the work. When I moved to Williamsburg, there was a lot of construction going on, and a lot of they were working on the bridge, reconditioning the bridge. So every day I would walk outside and I would see a pile of construction material, which was always really interesting to me because it changed every day. And I used to photograph them for inspiration. And then it was going to be a specific photo project, but it turned out that the colors from the photos started coming into my paintings a lot more, and then I started paying more attention to it, and then became more deliberate about actually using that as source material. So for years I painted from my surroundings very arbitrarily, looking at buildings going up. Lately they've changed into buildings coming down. Maybe September 11th had something to do with that. I started getting interested in earthquakes, natural disasters, because when I looked at a photograph of, say, an earthquake, there would be a lot of rubble. And when I zoomed in on it, it just became a beautiful thing, which is sounds a little strange to be inspired by something so terrible, but that's the overall gist of where my work is traveled from. So it's gone from construction to destruction, and now sort of the horizon has disappeared in a way.
So you find the beauty in the construction sites that are going up. Now you don't work for the real estate company, do you? So okay. Testing 1, 2, 3. Testing 1, 2, 3. We got to, honey, the next time, this is embarrassing. We're in Williamsburg and we're being embarrassed here, okay? Testing 1, this is next time we have to, those little mics. Okay, Mark, so you find beauty in these construction sites, huh? So you don't work for those real estate companies, do you? You're not a ringer. You're not in here to, you know, how much are they paying you to say that?
No, actually, at the time when it was all happening at the very beginning of the boom, I was critical of it because I didn't want the neighborhood to change. So there may have been a little political, you know, undercurrent to everything. I was celebrating the fact that the buildings weren't finished yet. They were in process. So I was always more interested in that. When the building actually was finished, it was less interesting to me.
So I'm only joking, by the way. I wanted to bring a little humor here, a little levity. Sometimes the art world gets very snooty and like too serious, right? We want to keep a little bit of a carnivalesque feeling, a little down to earth. But I think that you find beauty in this process, in this construction, and I think that's really very interesting. You know, I consider myself a constructivist philosophically. And our TV show is like we're building something, we're creating something new in the world. So things that are happening, there's a certain beauty in human making, like making something, whether it's a building or a rocket ship that goes to the moon. There's something artistic and aesthetic about that, as there is something aesthetic about a painting itself. So we're going to now move through the space, because we're going to have about maybe 10 more minutes of walking around, and then we're going to sit down and have a salon, a dialogue, and we're all going to be part of a conversation. But let's just do a quick walk through. Kathleen, go ahead, lead us.
All right.
Okay.
So for this piece, this is another piece of Mark's done also with the oil on the paper. And here you can really see the line work of how he's created the composition for it. And for Mark's pieces, what I really love about them, in addition to the complex composition, is his color palette and how he's used that to define the, you know, the contrast of the work, and then especially all of the paint brush marks and again, like I said, the line work of this piece.
We're trying to educate the public about art and aesthetics, and John Dewey is one of the education philosophers whose work I admire a lot. He talked about how the more you know about art, the more you know about the technical side of it, the vocabulary, like the line work, for example, the more there is to see. A lot of folks, when they come to a gallery, they get confused, particularly about modern art still today, unless you've been educated that way. So knowing something and hearing the words and the vocabulary, then I think it, people, when they're looking, they can know what to see in terms of the color and the line. But I also want to say that it's an aesthetic encounter being in this room. Being in this former factory, I want to bring Daniel into this conversation. Claudia, if you could just look over there at that window. I love that window. And the snow is coming down outside. I don't know if you could see the snow, but it just looks gorgeous. The gray tones of that window and the complexity of the tree outside and the snow. This was a former factory? Tell us about that, Daniel.
The whole building was an old factory building that was textiles. And actually, this used to be a factory where they made belts.
Rubber belts.
I don't know who bought them. They were kind of strange, but they made them here. And yeah,
occasionally. Well, I got my belt on right here, look. But it's not a weird belt, but it's a, okay, yeah.
Yeah, occasionally I'll still find a belt buckle around somewhere.
Oh, my God. That is so cool. And look at the ceiling, Claudia. Look up there. This is, how high? This is a high ceiling?
It's 12 feet, yeah.
Okay. So you guys get like a lot of folks in here, like when you have a gallery opening and it's like a social happening. How does it feel when this room is filled with people and they're conversing?
It's really fun. I mean, I feel like for us, we transformed it into an exhibition space for artwork, but we tried to retain as much of the original architecture of the space.
Okay.
So the window, it has its own character as well as the ceiling, but we've made it into a place that really feels authentic and true to what the neighborhood is.
And I want to tell everybody, this is the grittiest part of Williamsburg because there's graffiti outside and it still feels rough and raw. It doesn't feel gentrified here. We're going to take a peek in the back room there really quickly because you have some photographs of old shows. You very famously had a show about photographs of subway cars that were dumped into the Atlantic Ocean. These are like regular subway train cars, like the A train and the C train, and they wanted to build a reef, an artificial made reef, so that the crustaceans and the sea creatures and whatever wanted to we're going to take a look at that because that was in the New York Times.
Right,
that got you guys very famous.
That's by a photographer, Stephen Mallon,
okay.
And that was from a series called Next Stop Atlantic.
Uh-huh.
And he documented the artificial reef building program that the MTA did.
Let's take a look at it. We could tell more. As we walk in, Claudia, we'll keep walking. We're moving. We're making this up as we go along. I want you to know that. Okay, we don't do anything that's pre-scripted, not like those other TV shows where everything is have a script and all. We don't have scripts. I don't believe in scripts. So Kathleen, let's take a look. Yeah, okay.
It's called Train in the Sky, and this you can see some unusual aspect of a subway car that hopefully none of us in our lives ever see, which is the under part of the car. So this is when they're lifting the train car up to place them onto the barge that will then be ferried out into the ocean.
Yeah. Let's take a look at being dumped into the ocean. Mm-hmm. Wow. Could you imagine a subway car being dumped into the Atlantic Ocean? Look, this is could be the train you were on for the morning commute. You could have been sitting on that train reading a newspaper.
Yeah. So that piece there, it's called Virginia Placement, and that one's a really fantastic shot because you can see the train car in midair being dropped in, and you can see some of the dirt and things flying off.
There. Got you in the New York Times, right? Mm-hmm. Let's flip the camera around and look at that moon over there. I love that big moon because one of my favorite expressions is a moon rock of a revelation. And I think Williamsburg, when I discovered Williamsburg in, was it 2007, it was like a moon rock of a revelation for me. It was this incredible, magical land of art and creativity, and I feel that still, and it's such a pleasure to be here with y'all. And let's continue. We're going to go into the room now and have a conversation. We're going to sit down together, the three of us, the four of us, and have a dialogue. How about that?
Okay, that sounds great.
Okay, so we are continuing our dialogue here, and I do feel a little embarrassed because I messed up the names in the beginning, but, you know, I mean, we're a forgiving show, and we like to think the art world also is a place to experiment and to make mistakes, and now we're going to have a conversation, and I don't know what I'm going to say, and, you know, and it, but it's obviously will be about art and will be about Williamsburg, and but I just feel very grateful to be here, to be in dialogue with you, and I just want to express my dream is to one day that we will have portable mics for this show, that we won't have to have passing the mic around, but as long as we do have this old-fashioned mic passing it around, it's kind of like a talking stick. Like the old ancient practice of you, when you hold the stick, you speak your truth. And so we have about maybe 20 minutes left. And so anybody who feels inspired to say something about the work, say your name. You know, it's good to repeat the name so the audience also will learn who you are. We will learn who we are, too, because we're building community. This is a community building project, too. And anything you would like to express about the work, about art, about Williamsburg, about this gallery, and we'll just be interactive and go back and forth, and I'll pass the microphone around and facilitate a dialogue. So, and it's okay to sit with the silence too, because silence is okay, and silence is, you know, productive and creative, and so I'm not going to ask a question. I'm going to let something emerge.
I guess I could talk about this painting behind us since it's convenient.
And tell us your name again.
My name is Mark Masiga.
Okay.
So the title, I have to reference my list because the titles are a little bit complicated.
So you forget things too.
Yes, I always
do. Not just me. Thank you.
Okay. This piece is titled Look and See If Everything Got Up With Me. Sometimes the titles come from snippets of dialogue that I've seen in a movie or something.
Was that a movie that you, yep. Which movie was it?
Road to Utopia with Bob Hope and Bing Crosby.
I love the road movies. I thought it was only me. I was watching one on Turner Classics not too long ago, and it's like such a special treat. It's like they're so kitschy and
they're hilarious. But they, I have been thinking about the concept of utopia a little bit lately, and road, you know, maps maybe a little bit. So I think it relates in some way. And sometimes I'll think of an offbeat snippet of dialogue that has an information, a little bit of information that leads you into the painting or something.
When did you see that movie? Like, when did you have the encounter with Road to Utopia that gave you that inspiration?
Well, I think the first time was probably when I was a teenager, because I really loved old films.
How did you get that? Where did you get that, from your parents or grandparents, or did you pick it up on your own?
Probably because I grew up not liking popular culture and always sort of felt like I was born in the wrong decade.
What would have been your decade that you would love to have been, you know, if you could take a time machine back, what would be your magical decade?
Probably late 40s. The music was the best, I thought. Going from
Andrew Sisters.
Well, always they're always good. Maybe going through from blues to jazz into early rock and roll, which is like a gold mine. You know, it's a beautiful music. Always love that.
One of our guests that we had on last year, we were so lucky to have had him as a guest, was Joe Franklin. Yeah, Mr. Nostalgia, who really brought back that whole old TV, old movies, old music and stuff like that. So, wow, interesting how inspiration comes from different sources and fantastic. I used to love the old horror movies. Like my favorite was The Wolfman and Dracula and those Universal horror movies. Remember those movies? Yeah. What's the name of the photo of the painting behind us again? It's
Look and See If Everything Got Up With Me.
And do you remember, like, who was talking to who? Was it Bob Hope talking to Bing Crosby? And what was going on in the scene?
I think that was Bob Hope making a wisecrack to Bing Crosby. The plot of the movie was that these two guys they stole a map from a hidden gold mine in Alaska, and they got into all this trouble because they impersonated two killers, like lumberjack killers. And you know how
leave it to Bing and Bob.
So the antics ensued. They impersonated these killers and got into all sorts of trouble, trying to evade being killed themselves, and always looking for the pot of gold at the end of the rainbow, which they never find.
Who would have thought that we would come to Williamsburg, Brooklyn, the most cutting-edge, avant-garde art scene in the world, and talk about Bob Hope and Bing Crosby? You gotta love it. You gotta love that. But let's just sit with the utopian concept for a minute, because I think that Williamsburg, at its best, and we know there are obviously problems because there's nothing perfect, but at its best is a kind of a utopia. At least it was for me when I first discovered it in 2007 when I was teaching at Barriqua College. And it was such a thrill to get to come here twice a week and take the L train. And it was like an Oz, like the world, land of Oz kind of thing. So in terms of the sense of community and the art, how does that play out with you guys? I mean, are you critical of some elements? Do you feel it's a utopia or not? Or is that?
It's New York. We can't live here without being critical of just about everything, you know.
You're right.
Okay. One thing I would say, that when I first started the gallery, it was interesting here because it felt like you could really do anything. People started their own little restaurants, bookstores, all kinds of things, and they didn't have to have, you know, $500,000 in backing to do it. They could find a space and just do it. It's gotten a lot harder to do that now, but I think that was part of like the foundation of what made Williamsburg so interesting, was that there was kind of all these possibilities.
Yeah, I feel the possibilities. One of the quotes that I mention a lot on our show is a quote by Emily Dickinson, that imagination lights the slow fuse of the possible. Right? And that's one of my favorite quotes about art, along with John Dewey, when he said that the aesthetic is the opposite of the anesthetic. And I think in our society today, there's a lot of sleepwalking going on and people going through the motions. But when I come to Williamsburg, like you said, I feel that community and I get wide awake immediately. So why do you think Manhattan, you know, you would think they're pretty smart over there. Why wouldn't they try to duplicate this energy or feeling over there when it's not happening? It's so different. Why is Brooklyn? There are people who come to Brooklyn now who don't like to go to Manhattan. They say, oh, please, do I have to go? I have a friend who lives in Greenpoint. She's like, my God, I got to go to Manhattan today, you know. But so what is it about Brooklyn? I mean, we have an audience out there. Actually, Manhattan's watching now, so I hope they don't get too upset. But also, Hoboken is watching us. We're on the air in Hoboken, New Jersey. So Claudia and I live in a city that's more of a Brooklyn feel in terms of that small scale and sense of community. And also people watching around the world that could be watching us in Iceland or Australia. And what the heck is Williamsburg, Brooklyn? Kathleen, what do you think it is?
Oh, that's interesting. That's an interesting question. Okay. But for me, I feel like Williamsburg is built up from a lot of independent people that come out here to make their own way. And for small businesses, especially where they have a dream and an idea, and you can actually go and experience so many unique aspects of creativity here. And us, we're very lucky to run the gallery here and be able to introduce artists to the community and to be able to come to visit us. And
Well, I think we're ready to move in, right, Claudia? I saw you have a nice couch back there, and the other, there's a room adjoining. There's like a kind of a living space there. We don't take up much room, you know, just place for the camera, you know. You know, let's think also about, our show is about education, the arts, and social change. The name of our show is The Public Voice Salon, so we're doing it right now. We're the public, we're finding our voice, it's a community, and it's a salon. We're having a dialogue. But what about politics? There is a bigger world outside this gallery and outside of Williamsburg, and there's poverty, and there's unemployment, and there's economic difficulty, and there's inequality of wealth. What do you think is the connection between art and social change?
That's a tough one, really. Maybe I don't know. You want to do that one?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, maybe we can. I think the biggest challenge that we're facing right now is to educate people on what contemporary art is today, because I feel like a lot of people are intimidated by it. And as you were saying earlier, too, there's this different attitude that is taken on by Brooklyn. And we are very welcoming, and we take the time to help people to kind of understand what the artwork is about, what the artist is trying to portray in the work, and that it's not so complicated. It's not meant to be kind of impenetrable, this, you know, and we want to kind of help to educate people that way.
You just made me think of a story that my brother Rob, who was not that into modern art, let's say experimental art, and we used to have conversations about it, and then he got into photography, and I said to him, you know, you got to come to Williamsburg, you got to see what the scene is, you know. And I brought him here on one of those nights when it was like an art tour, and it was like a bus that went from Manhattan that brought us in here. And he went from like being skeptical about modern and postmodern to just being like, this is unbelievable. I had to pull him away. He was having such a good time in these galleries, but also talking to people and interacting and laughing. I remember he did a lot of laughing that night. And so that sense of that coziness. And so we need to bring more people into the dialogue, people at home watching, to come to these events and to not be afraid to express themselves. But I've talked a lot now. Let's just final thoughts, if anyone has, to our audience about art, about, you know, about your own process too, if you want to share something about your life in terms of where you're at with your growth. I think Claudia and I hit a big home run here today just by coming here. So we will definitely be back. But what are your final thoughts about today, about this dialogue?
You want to take this one?
Or anything. Yeah.
Well, we're really happy to share what we do here at the Front Room Gallery, and to be able to talk a little bit more about what's happening in Williamsburg. Mm-hmm. And we look forward to the future changes that are coming, and hopefully for the better. Yeah.
Thanks for having us.
Okay, you real estate people now, lower those rents. I want to see affordable housing for artists and creative people. And if you could have condos going for whatever they're going for, you need to keep room for the artists, because you know why? If the rents go up, they're all going to go to Bushwick. And we're not going to have any more galleries here. So, okay.
I just wanted to say I hope places like this continue to be able to exist, because it really does serve the community a lot, and it's great to be able to have the opportunity to show here.
One more thought about the power of love, that if it wasn't for Claudia being my wife and believing in my crazy dream of having a TV show as much as me, and being kind enough to film us here, that this wouldn't exist. So it's important to have love in our lives and relationship. And but thank you all for being part of this dialogue, and hopefully we will continue, and there's always more to say. The conversation will go on. Thank you.
All right, thank you.
Okay.